The sounds you have just heard are those of a muzzle-loading bronze cannon manufactured in Strasbourg, France, in 1761, the type used by Napoleon in his 1812 Russian campaign. It was this field piece that was used to produce the sounds of cannon fire heard during the course of this recording of the Tchaikovsky Overture 1812. Thanks to the wholehearted cooperation of the authorities and technical experts at the U.S. Military Academy at West Point, we were able to record actual cannon fire. Likewise, the authorities at Yale University in New Haven made it possible for us to record the bells of the famous Harkness Memorial Tower. Suppose we take you now to the hills behind West Point, overlooking the Hudson River, on that forenoon of January 20th, 1955. A specially recruited crew of ordnance experts are loading the cannon with black powder and tamping it down with wads of newspaper. A safety crew, complete with ambulance, is standing by. The cannon is about to be fired by the time-honored method of match and fuse. The microphone is placed about 150 yards in front of the cannon in a protected spot so that the blast will not shatter the diaphragm. A modest charge of powder is being used for the first firing. Now the fuse is lit. Well, that wasn't much of a noise. Evidently, everybody tried to play too safe. The microphone is next moved about 50 yards away from the cannon, still positioned in front. Now the fuse is lit once more. That still isn't very satisfactory, is it? At this point, it was decided to try a second microphone, placed about 75 feet behind the cannon, where it could pick up the booming reverberation to best advantage. Two shots were fired with this microphone set up, and they sounded like this. Well, it's hard to believe that those peculiar sounds were cannon fire. It seems as though the use of two microphones introduces what the audio engineers call phase distortion, with not very happy results. By this time, it was decided to use the tried and true living presence technique with a single microphone. At the same time, the powder charge used in the cannon was increased to the limit of safety. Now the fuse is lit. Here it goes. Well, that's more like it. If you don't believe it, you can play the shot once more and you'll hear the gun crew laughing with glee over their expert handiwork. As a matter of fact, it is this shot that was copied as many times as was necessary and used throughout where called for as part of the musical performance of the 1812 Overture recorded on this disc. Now let's shift the scene of our activity to the beautiful quadrangle of Brantford College, adjoining the imposing Gothic spires of Harkness Memorial Tower at Yale University. The date is January 4th, 1955. Again, it is bitter cold and very windy. There are 10 bells in the tower, ranging in size from 1,500 pounds to 7 tons. While the 7-ton bell is a long way from the 100-ton monster that hangs in the Tower of Ivan the Great at the Kremlin in Moscow, we can still make an approximation of the festive sound of Russia's bells on a great holiday. Now, here's what the bells of the Harkness Tower sounded like as originally recorded. If you listen carefully, you will also hear the wind whistling past our microphone, which was stationed at ground level in the Brantford College quadrangle, about 150 feet from the base of the tower. You'll also hear a Yale student passing by, whistling, as well as the distant noise of New Haven City traffic. I'm sure you'll agree that something is missing in this clamor of bells that is so thoroughly characteristic of the Russian variety. The bells don't sound brilliant enough, and there don't seem to be quite enough of them. But what can't be accomplished on the spot can be done with a few tricks of electronics and magnetic tape editing. To double the number of bells and add the brilliant high sounds, it was necessary only to copy what you have just heard at twice the normal speed, so that the sound is like this. Now, suppose we combine the high bells and the original tape recorded from the Harkness Tower at Yale. Here's the sound that results. Now this, we feel, is a really exciting bell sound and is as close as it is possible to come on this side of the Atlantic to the sound of the Kremlin bells as they must have rung in old Russia. Having prepared the raw material consisting of the clangor of bells and the boom of cannon, it was then necessary to integrate these sound effects with the music, which meant very careful editing of the sound effects tape so that it would synchronize exactly with the musical performance by Antal Doraty and the Minneapolis Symphony Orchestra, with bells and cannon entering at the places in the score designated by the composer. Here are the cannon shots as edited on this sound effects tape. On the very last cannon shot, you will hear the bells enter at the same moment, thus concluding with appropriately festive clamor.